Right, time for a bit of hardware hacking today. What I've done is I've bought this cheap old monitor from eBay. It was probably about 20 quid, I can't remember now exactly the price. It's an HP L1906, so it's a 19-inch monitor. The reason I got it cheap was because it's quite old and it hasn't got an HDMI input. Now, what I'd like to do with it is convert it to run on 12 volts to go in my car. So, here's the innards. That's the driver board. Obviously, here's the panel. It's quite a nice panel, and you can see in the back it's sort of integrated. It's got the TCON board, so that takes a 20-pin LVDS signal and converts it to the many channels of parallel signals that are needed to actually drive the monitor. And you can actually buy universal LVDS driver boards that would plug in here. And I did think about doing that because that would give me HDMI input and I could run that off 12 volts. However, that costs money. There's no point spending money if you don't have to. And this is the board that was in it. And okay, yes, it has only got SVGA input, but that's not the end of the world. It's still quite high resolution and it seems to work quite well. But obviously it's 240 volts, and the plan is to put this monitor in the car, and I'd rather not run it off an inverter, I'd rather run it directly from 12 volts. So, the task for today is to convert this board to run on 12 volts. So, for those who don't know, I'll just do a quick run through of how it actually works. Okay. So, make sure you can see that all right. What we've got here, the board's divided into three sections, okay? So we've got down this side, we've got the high voltage driver for the backlights, because I think it's a compact fluorescent backlight in this panel. So that'll be generating high voltage and high frequency to drive those CFLs. In the middle, this is a switch mode power supply. I presume what this is doing is generating something in the region of 12 volts to power the rest of the board. And then on the right hand side, we've got basically a converter that takes that signal from the SVGA and converts it into this LVDS signal. Now, it's a telltale sign that it is an LVDS signal, because if you look at these traces running to the connector here, they're all in pairs. That gives it away, because LVDS is sent over pairs. You have a positive and a negative side, and the difference between the two is your signal. So that shows that it's LVDS, basically. So this side of the board is driving, basically. This is power, and this is a CFL driver for the backlight. And going over to this side, let's just unplug this. These are buttons, obviously. Probably won't actually use them. On this side, right, let's just run through. Again, we've got, obviously, that's a microprocessor of some description, or possibly even a custom chip to generate the LVDS signals. I don't know, I haven't looked it up. That there looks to be some kind of firmware. And the two things that give that away is that it's socketed so that you can replace it, and it's got a sticker on it with, it hasn't actually got a date, but it has got a version number, so that'll be programmed with some software of some description. It's really surprised that it actually needs that, to be honest. I would have thought there's not a lot of firmware that goes into these things. So anyway, so this is all sort of digital, really, this side of the board. And here we've got the power supply again. And then here we've got the CFL drivers. So that's complaining. So the way it works, we've got high voltage, well, 240 volts coming in here. We've got various protection, we've got capacitors across it. So I think there's a more of a PTC in there somewhere. More capacitors, that's common mode choke. And then here we've got a rectifier. And then straight into a large tank capacitor. So that is your large input capacitor, and that you can see there is rated at 450 volts, so it's going to be charged to
presumably mains voltage, but as DC, so it'll be about 270 volts or something. So that's the one to watch out for if you're going to get zapped. That's going to be the one that zaps you. And then down here, this is a switch mode power supply. So that's presumably a MOSFET, and that's doing the actual switching there. And then we've got a transformer here, which produces the output. Over on the other side, you can see that'll be the chip that's actually doing the driving. Oops, can you see that? Yes, there's a tiny little soic on there that's producing the switching, and presumably driving that MOSFET, which is then driving this transformer. And then you can see this will be the ground isolation. Draw. This is the mains. It's the mains part of the circuit here. And you can see it's sort of. These are all isolated. There's actually holes drilled into it, which is presumably for some kind of additional isolation. So everything inside that box is at mains potential, potentially at mains potential. So you can see there's only a few points where it actually crosses over. This square here is the transformer, and then there's a capacitor across it here, and then that, which is an opto-isolator. If we look over at the other side of the board, so there's actually three components that cross over that isolation. There's this transformer, there's down here, there's this opto-isolator, and then one of these capacitors, I think it's that one, crosses over that mains isolation. And what happens is it comes down to here, and then we've got a rectifier, and this is a rectifier. So basically what's happening is we're taking the mains AC, converting to DC, driving the switch mode power supply, which is then producing a switched AC again, basically, to drive this transformer, and then we're rectifying it again. So we're getting DC again down here somewhere. And it's all very nice on this board because it's actually got a lot of the circuit symbols drawn on. I don't know how well you can see that on the camera there, but you can actually see that a lot of them are silk screened, not just the like C or R for the type of component. They've actually got the symbols drawn on there as well. That's pretty quite clear. You can see there's actually a coil symbol. Anyway, it's very, very easy to understand what's going on here. So we can see that we've got our AC coming over here. This is going to be a lower voltage AC by the time it gets to this point. So this goes to this ground plane, which is connected to earth ground and chassis ground. So all of this that goes all the way around here is ground. As you can see, one side of that transformer is connected straight to it, so it's ground referenced. And then this will be the positive side. Or rather, it will be once it's been rectified. So that there, this component right here, is another rectifier. It's only 3-pin, it's only got 2 diodes in it, but that is presumably because the signal that's coming through this transformer is actually only in the positive. It's referenced to ground, and one side of it is positive. So it's sort of not a true AC signal. So that's how switch mode power supplies work. So, I think that what we should have coming out of this rectifier here is a DC voltage in the region of about 12 volts that is ideal for what I would like to drive it from in my car. So, the plan is cut out all of this mains switch mode power supply up here and just pipe the voltage directly in around about here somewhere, where on the DC low voltage side of it, and then that goes into another two switch mode. Actually, I think we've got one of these as a switch. Yeah, look, here we've got another switch mode power supply. You can tell that there's a big coil. Now I have actually looked up the component number on this, and it's actually a sort of single component switch mode power supply. Single component plus a coil, and that's actually presumably generating 5 volts or 3 volts or whatever is needed for the logic solution. Then it's probably 3 volts actually. Cutting it off a bit. Yes, okay. So, what I'd like to do is put a DC voltage in at some point around here and have it drive both the logic side of the circuit and the inverters as well. So the first thing I'm going to do is identify where I'm going to solder my wires to. And one obvious place is the ground plane. It's definitely going to need a wire on the ground plane. And like I say, it's all connected together. It's mains earth referenced. So I could solder onto any point on that ground plane. And I reckon mark on ground, it's this basically. So I could solder onto this screw terminal here, but I will solder. It's quite nice, it's got exposed silk screen here. I'll solder onto a bit there. And then, like I say, we're over from this transformer here, we've got a rectified DC. It actually ends up here, and then there's a coil which is presumably a filter, and then it ends up on this plane. And this track here that leads around to here, this is the one that distributes power both to the inverter and to the logic side of the board. So that's where I'm going to solder my connectors to. So I'm going to put one on the ground plane, I'm going to put one onto that positive line that goes to both the inverter and the logic circuit that's driving the LVDS. So, let's put a soldering iron on. Then of course once I've put the wires on there, I'll measure the voltage that the board actually produces when it's plugged in normally, and then I'll feed that same voltage in to test it. So let's just see if I can prop this up whilst I solder it. There you go. Alright. So, ground first, I think. Let's solder. Maybe some flux on there, good idea. So this is the ground plane here, it's just flux that bit there. Oops, there you go, it's covered in flux. So, hopefully this is going to solder on quite nicely. Put that in a position where it rests nicely. There we go. So I'm now soldering a black wire onto the ground plane. You never quite know sometimes with these boards that it will take. Sometimes it won't. Sometimes you have to sand a little bit off, because although we've got exposed tinned soldering wires, hot enough. I guess that ground plane is drawing away quite a lot of that heat. So I haven't got any solder to stick to it at all. How good is it? Right, perhaps you've picked a bad location for it. There's a lot of copper there, so it's probably being heat sinked away. I've got my soldering iron on hot as it will go, so let's try and find a less heat sunk part of it, shall we? I'm gonna go for look somewhere up here. Let's try soldering onto there. So this is all the same ground plane. Just connected to mains earth. You can see this is mains earth here. So let's just see if I can get that to actually tin at all. And if I, there we go. A little bit sort of slowed onto it there. So hopefully I should now be able to just tin this wire properly. Hopefully that's now going to
make a nice connection there. I need a soldering iron with a bigger thermal mass. Right, there we go. So that's ground. And then we need to find a nice suitable point to solder on for the positive as well. And like I say, it's actually this track here that we're looking for. I suspect I'm going to have the same problem again, where it's quite well heat sunk. There's a lot of copper on that board. And heat sinks, so let's try and find a point where it's probably less heat sunk. Suspect that there might be a good spot. Let's try that. Let's go for the flux first. See if I can get the solder to flow there. Oh yes. There we go. Tin and wire. See if I can make a nice connection on there. Suspect that I might be using the wrong type of solder. I often find that if a board has got lead-free solder in it, and then you try and add leaded solder or vice versa, trouble getting the two to flow together. I find that anyway. There we go. Happy with that. Not the best solder joint in a while, but it is okay. Right, where's the snaps? So, hopefully these are the two points where I can now feed my DC into it from my car, and I won't have to worry about running an inverter to keep it powered. So the first thing that I'm going to do is hook up my meter. Let's get this out a bit. There we go. First thing I'm going to do is have a sip of beer. And then I'm going to take my meter. Oh crap. Beer exploded. Right. So I'm going to take my meter and I'm going to measure what voltage we get at this point when it's plugged in normally. I could have done that before I soldered the wires on, but I'm pretty confident that this is the right location for doing it. So, do some crocs on this. So, not that it really matters. So I'm reading nothing at the moment. You see that right? Bastard reflection is the bane of the YouTuber's life. Good enough, right? I think so. Okay. So power then.
recommend you try this unless you know what you're doing. Because I'm about to plug this into 240 volts, and there is obviously a shock hazard. There we go. Come on. Oh, would you look at that? You probably can't see it. There we go. 12 volts exactly. That's perfect. I don't even need to convert it from my car. I might regulate it because I don't want it to be blown from the cranking of the engine, etc. But there we go. We've got 12 volts, so that's perfect. So. But those two points are where my 12 volts are, and that's where the input's going to go. So let's carefully unplug this now. Hands away from the inverter. Now, the other thing I need to do now is discharge the caps in this. So, put it on the ground. I could have left that where it was actually. What I'll do is. I've written on here that's a dangerous cap there. Dangerous caps over here as well. So let's just short them out. There's more over here, the inverter caps. I'm not particularly worried about the inverter caps because I know that they're low. Anyway, right, that's safe. So, this question now, will it work if I just plug 12 volts into it? I think what I might do though, is remove the main part of the circuit from it completely. I think I'll desolder the, if I can anyway, I'll desolder the filter, transformer. So that it's the switch mode part of it's just completely not in use, not connected. So if I can get it come off, I'll have to use the solder wick. I will solder it, probably be alright with it left in there for now. I will desolder it at a later date probably, so can't be bothered. What I really want to know is, will this panel work with 12 volts fed into it. So, I'm not going to worry about the inverter just yet. I just should be able to see something on the screen even with the backlight not plugged in. Right, so I spent so long fiddling with the bloody LVDS connector that my memory card ran out of space, so I've just had to go and copy some stuff off. Anyway, let's try again. I've now got this connected, hopefully correctly, and hopefully I haven't ruined the flatflex in the process. I really hate these flatflex connectors. They're not robust enough for me. Anyway, what I'm going to do now, I think, is I've actually got a piece of rubber and I'm going to stick this underneath. And then I think what I'll do is just tape it. Temporarily, this is just tape it down. And that's just so that I can. So that I can test it without ruining the connectors, really. Pulling it out. So, let's put that there. Duct tape. Good old duct tape. Thank you.
tape over the actual connector itself, because that will probably ruin it. And a bit down the side as well. It's relatively solid there. Right, I might as well connect this inverter up as well. What was it? Nothing goes there. There are polarity on this. Yes, it looks like. Goes in there. Goes in there. So these are for the backlight. There's really, it's nicely routed, routed out around here for high voltage arcing over suppression. It's sort of fairly nicely designed board, this one, and there are a few things I don't like about it. For example, these capacitors just sort of flapping around in the breeze there, not so good. But oh, I connected these the wrong way around. Blue nearest this end. I don't know if that matters. I don't think it does with a compact fluorescent. But might as well connect it up the way it's supposed to be. Okay. Yeah, so it's interesting, there's actually two inverters here and two sets of CFL. Not quite sure why. Put these buttons up as well, and then we can test it. So I've called up some 12 volt action on the old power supply. Find a banana plug somewhere. There's one. Alright, 12.4, close enough. Alright. Black to black. Red to red. Where is it? There we go. Hope it doesn't quite reach. So. Or we may not have enough current on this power supply. It's dipped. Is it on? Ooh, that light appears to be vaguely on. Is there anybody home? Yeah, I think we need to get a 12 volt supply that's actually going to deliver enough current. So that's a 1 amp supply. Alright, I'm just going to run into the other room and go and get another 12 volt supply. Right, here we go then. Now, I didn't actually check the current draw on this when before I started taking it apart, so if it's going to draw a load of power, that could be an issue. Because it needs to run in the car, and I don't particularly want to flatten my battery every time I turn it on. Let's just see what we get. It's drawing more than 1 amp at 12 watts. That's 12 watts, which is doable. 12 watts I could cope with. If it's much more than that, I'm going to have some trouble. So. There we go. What for that set to? 3 volts a minute. start the current doing it.
Very low, not that low.
Okay.
So, just going to put this. This one should deliver 3 amps. So, I hope that's enough. If it wasn't, won't run on 3 amps, it's not really suitable to go in the car, to be honest. Red to red again, and back to back. Right, so how many amps does it need? Oh, there we go. 1.8, why is it not 13 amps? It's all over the place. So we're drawing two amps at 12 volts, 24 watts. So I can cope with that. I can see through the screen already that the backlight's come on, which is a good start. So, let's have a look. Check video cable. Can you see that? So I've successfully converted this monitor to run on 12 volts. Get the menu up, I think that one's a menu. No. No. No menu. I haven't got an SVGA signal I can plug into it, but you can see by the fact that it says check video cable that it's actually working. So that's lovely. So, job's a good one, really. It's done. Yeah, I will check it with an SVGA signal. In fact, I might have a look here. HDMI to it. I will check that later, but I'm confident that that's actually going to work now. Oh, gone off. Why is it gone off? I'll turn it off. VGA input, no input signal. 128/1024. It's not a bad resolution, is it? Well, the on-off button works anyway. I'd kind of expect to be able to get the menu up as well, to be honest. Apparently, no menus unless there's a signal on it. I would assume that the signal works. So when it's off, it's drawing 20 milliamps. So it's going to be on a switched circuit anyway, so it won't draw anything when the car's not running. But when it's on, yeah, 2.15 amps at 12.4. Get that dead on 12. 2.26 amps. 24 watts, yeah, it's not too bad. Well, it's about 20, what's that, 25, 26 watts. It's doable for quite a large screen, I suppose. It's not going to be running the whole time in the car, and I probably will have the engine running most of the time. I mean, this is mainly going to be for sitting in the back of the car watching films and stuff. I wanted a nice HD screen for watching HD films on, really. So, yeah, done. Cool. I'm gonna finish this video here then.